call one day from our administrative bishop on the reservation. He said, "You're supposed to be here in 2 weeks." I said, "Yes, sir, that's right." He said, "Be prepared to teach 5 1-hour lessons on stewardship in 2 weeks." Well, Greg knows, and the pastor knows, that is not an easy task. To be ready for 5 1-hour plus overheads, plus outlines. And then Sister Berg has gone and folded. She took care of the outlines. I made them. She took care of them. She took care of the books. These are all books made by her. I just give her the stuff. And she put them together. And I just prayed the Lord for that, because it's working. God had to settle me down in order to get there.
Yes, sir.
It's entirely different between teaching and preaching.
Right.
Amen. A lot of people weep when they preach it. You don't say amen or oh,
that's true.
I'll just let the anointing do it.
But when it comes to teaching, God expects you to say something.
Yeah.
That people will learn something.
Yeah.
And I think we need teaching. We've got to have teaching.
Yes.
Preaching is great. If I have a choice between preaching and teaching, it would be tough. Because I love to do both. I love to teach them to preach. But the anointing took over several times. The administrator, bishop, had his pocket watch, and I hear him tapping on it. I was at a disadvantage, Pastor, because my Arab class came just before them.
Oh, wow.
Four of them came before, three of them came before them. I did not. Then the other two came just before break time at 4 o'clock. So. Don't you love the Lord?
Amen.
Amen.
You don't have to answer this. I just want to ask you the question. Pastor already covered this a little bit. What do you think when you first hear the word stewardship? Most of us respond typically like, well, Pastor's fixing to take up an offer. He's going to buy something. He wants something. He's going to take up an offer for something. That's stewardship. Come on, amen.
Amen.
He's probably going to buy something we don't even need. And too often, stewardship's discussions focus on how to raise money for the church budget. And that's it. And while stewardship does include how we get and how we spend and how we give our money, it's a very, very narrow definition of stewardship. Very narrow. As church fund raising begins to fall short, comprehensive understanding of what stewardship really means, and we need to come to place and search God's Word to see what God has to say about stewardship. So a biblical understanding of stewardship is so tremendously important, and it rests on the foundation that God is the creator and the owner of all things.
Amen.
Amen. Psalms 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord and ever is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it." So we begin to say people do not truly own anything. You know, we just seen what the richest man in the world moved to outer space this week. And I thought, that's no big deal. I'm fixing to go there. You know, you don't have to have the spaceship to get up there. But he turned around and come back. I'm not coming back for a while.
That's right.
I'm going to be there for a while, and I'm not going to have a spaceship or a suit or anything going.
Amen.
But he said, "The earth is the Lord." and in it. The world and all who live in it belong to God. And we forget that sometimes. The few meager possessions we have actually belong to God.
Yeah.
And people do, really, we don't own anything. And Paul said it this way in 1 Corinthians, this then is how you ought to regard us as servants of Christ. Now, most of us, or all of us, none of us want to be a servant. But listen, if you work on a job, you're a servant.
Yeah.
Amen.
That's right.
You're a servant to somebody or to something somewhere along the way. We're servants of Christ and those entrusted with the mysteries God has revealed. Now, this mysteries of God, that's an entirely different lesson. It's a problem about a bachelor's problem about a 5-week lesson by itself, just that one word. But the mysteries, or we can use another word, secrets, things of God, include God's Word. Amen. And I would dare say most Christians don't spend enough time in this mystery of God.
Right.
Amen. We don't spend enough time in the mystery of praying to God or being alone with God. We don't understand, most Christians don't understand how Jesus operates. How can he forgive me of my sins? Because he's the master. You know, people don't understand the mysteries of his death and his dying upon the cross and us receiving salvation and sanctification and all these things. How can he take some old, poor old somebody who was worthless and make somebody happy?
Right.
I know what that means. I hadn't always been the nice guy y'all think I am. But after nearly 54 years in the ministry, I've come to realize that I know very little about the Bible. Very little. Actually, I think you probably understood that.
Yeah.
You probably understand that.
Yeah.
Because I didn't even know until this week, last week, Job was an old man. I didn't know that. I shared it with my wife. She said, well, that means olive oil. I said, it does not mean olive oil. I said, Job took oil out of the rock. That's an old man, brother.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Praise God.
That's what we know.
Some of y'all really need to get more excited.
Joe must have been from Texas.
That's what I said, from Texas.
So when we begin to talk about and realize that we're entrusted with the mysteries of God, think about that now. We're entrusted with the mysteries of God. Mm-hmm. That excites me to know. Stewardship comes under that head of the mysteries of God. So within this understanding, we cannot truly give anything to God that we have because it already belongs to God. Mm-hmm. And God says, I want you to return a portion, mm-hmm. not out of a sense of duty, but as a response to the gracious love of Christ, but out of a sense that I want to bless God, not only with finances, but with time, with talent, with efforts, doing things that I normally would not do. In Jesus, we see these gifts operational. And a lot of times, you know, when I first come across this, I thought, well, this can't be right. But then I began to think about it. Jesus had gifts.
Yep.
Think about that now. Jesus knew how to teach.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He did.
Well, he was the Son of God, yes, but he was also man.
Yes, yeah.
He was also flesh and blood.
Yes.
He was also taught. At young age, about the things of God. He also had the gifts of teachings. He knew about death. He knew about resurrection. He knew about healing. He knew about it all. He was taught mainly by the Father. And I dare say Jesus is wanting to teach us a lot more than we're wanting to receive.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's true. Yeah.
And I say, Lord, teach me. Because I need to be taught.
Yes.
And sometimes we don't want to be taught because the teaching is too hard. You see, it's a lot easier for you to sit through a preaching service than it is a teaching service, because preaching, you just, it'll be done in a minute.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
But teaching makes us begin to think, who is God? What does God have to say about stewardship? First of all, this is over already.
No, I just had a comment. He's like, I just had a
comment. Tell me one time, just I've forgotten all my thoughts. Time's up, just raise your hand.
I want to hear where God tells us to not give grudgingly,
yes,
or of necessity, but out of the gratefulness of our heart.
Right.
I think that not only applies to giving our tithes and our offering, but I think that applies to the work that we do for Him.
Amen.
Because sometimes we get in and we begin to work for the Lord. Then we go home and we grumble and grumble. Go, can't get anybody else to do it, so I have to do it. You know, so we've lost our blessing right there.
Everybody hear what she said?
Yeah.
Give practically, we lose our blessing.
Yeah.
We need to be careful.
It also said that when Jesus rose, He gave gifts to all men. As He was leaving, so that meant He had His gifts first,
yeah,
and then He gave it to us here on the earth.
So He couldn't give something He didn't have.
Exactly. Yeah. So He had all those gifts.
Amen. That's good. Stewardship becomes a way of life. If there's anything, is this the only thing you remember through this whole portal? Is that, remember, stewardship is a way of life. It's not something you come in and do on Sunday morning or Wednesday night. It's something you're invested in.
Yeah.
Listen to that. I'm invested in.
Right.
I'm invested in the kingdom.
Yeah.
Amen. This is my depot right here, but I'm invested in the kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
And all my traveling, I've been invested in a lot of places, but I'm invested here. This is home. I come home to get fed and get renewed, so I go back out younger and be a steward.
Yeah.
In my time and in my efforts. And it becomes a way of life. I don't have to be pushed into it. I don't have to be begged into it. I don't have to even be threatened into it.
Right.
I don't have to be told, if you don't do this, you're going to bust hell wide open. But I do it because I'm invested in the kingdom of heaven. Amen?
Yeah.
And so many people miss this investing. Investing, investing, investing. You know, when I hear, we hear, we all hear, you know, the dollar's going down, gold and silver's going up, investing in gold and silver. Let me tell you, the dollar's going down, invest in Jesus. You see what Jesus is going to do. Amen. We forget this so many times that we must put God first in everything. I don't care what it is. Anything that has to do with life, God has to come first. You can't come second, can't come third. Well, what about my family? I put God first, and God will help me take care of the rest of it if I just do what I'm supposed to. So we must let God do what God wants to do. He entrusts us with the resources that He has given to us. Now, all of us don't give the same amount. Amen?
Amen.
All of us don't have the same talents.
Right.
Because if we had all the same talent, it'd get pretty boring, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
If everybody talked the way I talk, Pastor, and everybody preached the way I preach, it would get pretty boring after a while.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
Think about that, because we need diversity.
Yeah.
Yes.
We need different thinking. We need God moving in different directions in different areas. And one person can't do it all. Jesus could have done it all by himself. He wouldn't need to join the disciples. Come on.
Yeah.
But he needed somebody to help him. Do you think, I know what, I can hear some of you laying on me right now. But he needed somebody to walk with him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Agreement.
He needed somebody that he could hold hands with along the way.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Yeah.
He needed somebody to pray with him. Could you not pray with me just 1 hour?
Mm-hmm.
You see, that was part of their stewardship, and they missed it.
Yeah.
You know, and again, stewardship is not just about money. Prayer is stewardship.
Yeah.
That's why I said daily. So if you outline, if you look at several Greek words used in the New Testament, meanings in English help us to clarify some understanding. Okos means the home of the household. Okonomos is the household manager or administrator, the steward. Okonomia signifies the management or administration of a household. Stewardship. See, the difference between steward and stewardship. Stewardship means I'm doing what a steward does. I've got the job of a steward, so I've got to be doing what the steward does. Okomene means the whole world, God's entire household. He expects us to be stewards in the household of God. And He's placed us in this church to be stewards in this church.
Yeah.
And He placed us in Owensburg to be stewards in Owensburg.
Right.
He placed us on this west side of town to be stewards on the west side of town. Not that we can't go to the east side of town and be a steward and get some of them to come over to the west side. Come on.
Yep.
Amen. He put me in as a steward to be a steward on the Navajo and Apache Nation.
That's right.
Amen.
Yep.
So He put us in places that He wants us to be, and there's a reason for this. That He has a job for each one of us to do, and it's time for us as a church to start doing these jobs.
Amen.
So we see Jesus in stewardship. In addition to the words related to stewardship, we learn from Jesus' parable how to live as a steward. In the parable of the talents, Jesus depicted three slaves. We all know this story. Who were each entrusted with money or talent, whichever word you want to use. And as their master left on a long journey, they were to do and make their talents grow. So Jesus left us here for a reason. He didn't leave us here just to come to church and go back home.
Right.
And wait for the next service to come. Well, I'm going to sit here. Sister Melissa, get me going here in a minute. And she'll hit a high note and go, woo! Then we'll set it back down. That's not His intention. He left on a long journey and said, I'm leaving you to do a job while I'm gone. And we know the story. The first lady received 5 talents. Worthy value of $58,000, returned $291,000. After you need some people in your church.
Yeah.
The second servant, 2 talents, about $29,000, and returned $116,000. The third servant received just 1 and didn't bring any. lesson, we can say this is an illustration about the diligence in view of Christ's return. What will he find us doing? What kind of steward will we be when he breaks the eastern sky?
Yeah.
You see, when we hear the trumpet sound, we can't be running around trying to get people saved during that time.
No.
It'll be too late. What I do for the kingdom, I got to do now. Because I don't have the promise of tomorrow.
Right.
Sure. I don't even have the promise of tonight.
Yeah, not even the next minute.
Really, I don't even have the promise of getting down the building tonight. Mm-hmm. So what I'm going to do, I've got to do now. And when we begin to look, that when the master returns, we have to look at that. What are we going to do when the master returns? Well, as he tells us in Matthew 4:17, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, so what I do for the kingdom, I've got to do now. Amen?
Amen.
I can't wait till tomorrow. After you couldn't wait till 8 or 9 o'clock to go see what the smoke was on.
Right, right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
But I would almost guess that when the trumpet sounds and we're gone, this building will be full.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Sure will.
But there won't be any stewards here. You understand that? There'll be some people here begging. There'll be some people here pleading. Then he tells us in Luke 11:55-13, he teaches us that God will provide us with the resources we need. God will provide us with the resources we need. And again, our brain goes right back to money. And if there's one thing I want to get off of your brain is money.
Yeah.
Money. Money. Money.
It's bigger than
the resources. This is the resource.
Right.
Right here. This is the resource. And when I hear people saying that they're doing away with their Bibles, don't do away with your Bible. When it's on my phone, but it don't have the power this has. I can't hit nobody with my phone. I can hit them with my Bible. Praise the Lord. Come on, amen. And nothing will get you like thumbing through this book.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Come on. Because my finger gets tired of doing that on the phone. But I can go through this. My date Bible, I don't do that. But I begin to think God will provide the resources in Luke 11:5. And God's generosity is evident in the parable of the laborers in the vineyard. And our generosity, our willingness, and I've been in places and I've seen people begin to, the Holy Spirit begin to move them. People begin to throw their rings and their stuffs and, you know, their jewelry in the basket because the Holy Spirit was moving.
Yeah.
And there was a need. There was a need in the church. And so, but how can you do that? Because God told you to do that. Amen?
Yeah, amen.
Satan will never tell you to throw down the ring.
Right.
All the bank.
Oh. Right.
He may tell you to take one out, but he won't tell you to take the other one out. And we see the parable of the Good Samaritan. We know that parable. The one who found the man lying in the ditch and took care of him. We know the parable of the sower. And shows that stewards are of God's word. As stewards, we are to respond to it in our life. I just don't take this book and read it and lay it aside. I begin to live this book.
Yes.
Yeah.
You're a walking scripture.
Amen. I begin to live it. And I know as we get older, some of them begin to slip out one ear or the other, but I still go back again and refresh and refresh and refresh and refresh. You know, most of you know, I think I'm fixing to go my 39th year of reading the Bible through, and boy, it just gets more exciting every day, like finding out Job was an old man. Oh, man, that's neat. A Texican. And the point Christ conveyed by these illustrations, his teachings, were also so clear. Well, Pastor, we can just ourselves get that kind of clarity in our teaching.
Yeah.
And preaching. This is the way, walk ye therein it.
Amen.
What does he mean by it? This is the way. And his teachings were always so clear and to the point. Never did people get lost. Listen to me now. Never did people get lost when they were seeking the truth.
Yeah.
Amen. We get lost when we don't want to hear the truth.
Yeah, right.
But when the truth condemns us, or when the truth makes us feel bad, he hurt my feelings. And the people heard, and they could hear, and you know this, but they often would not accept and receive the truth. Even when Christ applied this to the Lord to further answer his questions of how to inherit eternal life, and realizing that anyone who is in need is our neighbor. Anyone. Anyone that we have the opportunity to help is our neighbor. And I heard Pastor just a week or so, or 2 weeks ago, talk about paying forward.
Mm-hmm.
Is that paying forward or paying backwards?
Forward.
And we just signed some time back. I was in the grocery store and picked up a few things. And I looked behind me. There was a homeless man. He had to be homeless. He looked homeless. He smelled homeless. He had to be homeless. And he had some stuff there. And I just told the lady, I said, pay for his along with mine. He said, sir, you don't have to do that. I said, yes, I do. I said, I'll just stand over here and you ring his up, I'll pay for his too. I didn't do that for glory. I did that because the Holy Spirit said he needed to feel somebody care.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
That's right.
That's deep. Good.
And sometimes people need to know somebody. Me and you need to know somebody. We need to know somebody cares.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
I just want to know. Does anybody care? Amen?
Yes.
Amen.
And we see people all day long if you're moving around. And whatever you do during the day, you'll find people who just want to know somebody knows they're alive. Mm-hmm. This is Jesus saying, this is what stewardship is. It goes beyond giving. It goes to caring.
Amen.
I begin to love. And I had a problem praying. And I told the Father, I said, Father, I don't know how to pray for the United States. I just simply do not know how to pray. And he said, let me tell you how to pray. First John, beloved, let us love one another.
Yes.
For love is of God.
Yes.
The one that loveth is born of God, and he that loveth not knoweth not God, is God as well.
Yeah.
Amen. He said, now go to 1 Corinthians and give gifts to the fruit He said, you need to start, learn how to start operating in these areas. Come on, amen.
Yeah.
Amen. What? That's stewardship.
Yes.
That's stewardship. I know people, I've had people say, you just, as a preacher, you just had too much fun. I said, if you've known me before, Sister Bertie, tell you, I was an honor graduate. I didn't like nobody. Except for earning four kids. Three kids at that time. Come on.
Yeah.
But something got a hold of me, but it wasn't enough that I come to know Christ. I had to become a steward also.
Yes.
I had to be willing to wait on people. I had to be willing to serve people. And that was hard for me to learn when I went into the ministry, that I had to start serving people. Because I don't like people. Or I didn't like people. Is that good about not? That about sums it up. Something got a hold of me, and I began to love people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because you can't follow Christ and not love people.
That's right.
Because if you don't love people, you're not following Christ.
That is right.
Amen.
Amen.
You say, what's this got to do with stewardship? Love is a part of stewardship.
That's right.
See, this is just the introduction. We're going to get into the good stuff next week. But see, and what he is saying, I want to teach, he taught, and I want to learn to teach. The rest of us need to learn to teach whether people receive it or don't receive it. That's not my responsibility. My responsibility, your responsibility, is to teach God is love.
Yeah.
For God so loved. That's my responsibility.
Amen.
So we go on to stewardship in the church. We're called to be trustworthy stewards of God's mysteries. Then we go further through the study. How? We highlight stewardship issues as they appear in small groups, curriculum, leadership activities. Biblically, we begin to go through these things and work through these things. We listen to the pastor. We listen to the others who come to us for these kind of things. And stewardship is an ongoing process. It does not stop.
Right.
Amen. I used to hear preachers say, in fact, in my homiletics class, and I'll take on the role of the professor now. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you teach on stewardship, preach on stewardship once a year. Make it at the beginning of the year, the first Sunday, usually in January. That's kind of my way. Because if you hit it any more than that during the year, then you will upset a lot of people. Well, let me tell you something. If this upsets you, then you need to find your knowledge.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Something's gone wrong.
Yeah.
And if stewardship, teaching, and preaching upset you, you need to run to the altar because something's going on in your relationship to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because we must teach stewardship, biblical stewardship. We must teach it starting at a very young age. So the job of stewardship, the job of supervising and taking care of something such as an organization and the property, covers the responsibility of the management of all resources along with the biblical view of stewardship. Remember, it's not only money, but it's time and talent, ability. And the list can go on. But can't hide our light under a bushel and say, I'm doing this for Jesus. No. Get that light out and begin to do what God has called upon you to do.
Yeah.
Be what God has called upon you to be. And realize that utilizing and managing all the resources that God provides for us is for the glory of God and the kingdom of heaven. Not just to be whining about it all the time, but just do what God has called you to do.
Yeah.
And God don't expect more out of you than He has called you to do.
Right.
I want to say that again. God doesn't expect more out of you than what He has called on you to do. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Think about that. Some of you have to get that going. But at the same time, I want to say, well, I may not be back next week. 99.9% of you, of us here, have not reached our potential in the kingdom of heaven.
Oh, absolutely.
I learned, the first time I learned that was in Greek classes when I had to learn the Greek to be able to speak in the Greek to the professor. And I said, I can't do that. And somebody in this room said, yes, you can. I won't tell you who her is. And when he is saying, you can do anything I call you to do. I will not call you without giving you the ability to do it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
If you seek me,
yes,
you'll find me.
Right.
When you seek me, I'll be
your
God.
Yeah.
Pastor.
Wow. Give the Lord a hand clap tonight.